Welcome to The Making of a Nation, American History in VOA Special English. I'm Steve Ember. Today we tell about life in the United States during the 1960s. The 1960s began with the election of the first president born in the 20th century, John Kennedy. For many Americans, the young president represented a spirit of hope for the nation. When Kennedy was murdered in 1963, many felt that their hopes died too. This was especially true of young people and members and supporters of minority groups. A time of innocence and hope soon began to look like a time of anger and violence. Many Americans protested to demand an end to the unfair treatment of black citizens. Many more protested to demand an end to the war in Vietnam. And many protested to demand full equality for women. By the middle of the 1960s, it had become almost impossible for President Lyndon Johnson to leave the White House without facing protesters against the war in Vietnam. In March of 1968, Johnson announced that he would not seek another term in office. In addition to President Kennedy, two other influential Americans were murdered during the 1960s. Civil rights leader Martin Luther King Jr. was shot in Memphis, Tennessee in 1968. Several weeks later, Robert Kennedy, John Kennedy's brother, was shot in Los Angeles, California. He was campaigning to win his party's nomination for president. The two murders resulted in riots in cities across the country. The unrest and violence affected many young Americans. The effect seemed especially bad because of the time in which they had grown up. By the middle 1950s, most of their parents had jobs that paid well. They expressed satisfaction with their lives. They taught their children what were called middle-class values. These included a belief in God, hard work, and service to their country. Later, many young Americans began to question these beliefs. They felt that their parents' values were not enough to help them deal with the social and racial difficulties of the 1960s. They rebelled by letting their hair grow long and by wearing unusual clothing. Their dissatisfaction was strongly expressed in music. Rock and roll music had become very popular in America in the 1950s. Some people, however, did not approve of it. They thought it was too sexual. These people disliked the rock and roll of the 1960s even more. They found the words especially unpleasant. The musicians themselves thought the words were extremely important. As singer and songwriter Bob Dylan said, "There would be no music without the words." Bob Dylan produced many songs of social protest. He wrote anti-war songs before the war in Vietnam became a violent issue in the United States. One was called "Blowin' in the Wind."
How many roads must a man walk down before you call him a man? How many seas must the white dove sail before she sleeps in the sand? Yes, and how many times must the cannonballs fly before they're forever banned? The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind.
In addition to songs of social protest, rock and roll music continued to be popular in America during the 1960s. The most popular group, however, was not American, it was British, the Beatles. Four rock and roll musicians from Liverpool.
Oh yeah, I'll tell you something. I think you'll understand. When I say that something, I wanna hold your hand. I wanna hold your hand. I wanna hold your hand.
The Beatles' song, I Want to Hold Your Hand, went on sale in the United States at the end of 1963. Within 5 weeks, it was the biggest selling record in the country.
Let me hold your hand. I wanna hold your hand. And when I touch you, I feel happy inside. It's such a feeling that my love.
Other songs, including some by the Beatles, sounded more revolutionary. They spoke about drugs and sex, although not always openly.
Picture yourself in a boat on a river with tangerine trees and marmalade skies.
In the 1960s, do your own thing became a common expression. It meant to do whatever you wanted without feeling guilty. 500,000 young Americans did their own thing at the Woodstock Music Festival in 1969. They gathered at a farm in New York State. They listened to musicians such as Jimi Hendrix and Joan Baez, and to groups like The Who and Jefferson Airplane.
Look what's happening on the street, got a revolution. Hey, I'm dancing down the street, got a revolution. Hey, been breathing on the people I meet, got a revolution.
Woodstock became a symbol of the young people's rebellion against traditional values. Many young people called themselves hippies. Hippies believed there should be more love and personal freedom in America. In 1967, poet Allen Ginsberg helped lead a gathering of hippies in San Francisco. No one knows exactly how many people considered themselves hippies, but 20,000 attended the gathering. Another leader of the event was Timothy Leary.
Now, energy comes.
He was a former university professor and researcher. Leary urged the crowd in San Francisco to tune in and drop out. This meant they should use drugs and leave school or their job. One drug that was used in the 1960s was lysergic acid diethylamide, or LSD. LSD causes the brain to see strange, colorful images. It can also cause brain damage. Some people say the Beatles' song, Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds, was about LSD.
Well, now take down your fishing pole and meet me at the fishing hole. We may not get a bite all day, but don't you rush away.
As many Americans were listening to songs about drugs and sex, many others were watching television programs with traditional family values. These included The Andy Griffith Show and The Beverly Hillbillies. At the movies, some films captured the rebellious spirit of the times. These included The Graduate and Dr. Strangelove.
Deterrence is the art of producing in the mind of the enemy the fear to attack. And so, because of the automated and irrevocable decision-making process which rules out human meddling, the doomsday machine is terrifying. It's simple to understand and completely credible and convincing.
Gee, I wish we had one of them doomsday machines.
Gold finger, he's the man with the Midas touch, a spider's touch.
Other films offered escape through spy adventures like the James Bond films. Many Americans refused to tune in and drop out in the 1960s. They took no part in the social revolution. Instead, they continued leading normal lives of work, family, and home. Others, the activists of American society, were busy fighting for peace and racial and social justice.
I am woman, hear me roar, in numbers too big to ignore, and I know too much to go back and pretend.
Women's groups, for example, were seeking equality with men. They wanted the same chances as men to get a good education and a good job. They also demanded equal pay for equal work. A widely popular book on women in modern America was called The Feminine Mystique. It was written by Betty Friedan and published in 1963. The idea known as the feminine mystique was the traditional idea that women have only one part to play in society. They are to have children and stay at home to raise them. In her book, Ms. Friedan urged women to establish professional lives of their own. In the early 1960s, a committee was appointed to investigate the condition of women. It was led by Eleanor Roosevelt. She was a former First Lady. The committee's findings helped lead to new rules and laws. The 1964 Civil Rights Act guaranteed equal treatment for all groups. This included women. After the law went into effect, however, many activists said it was not being enforced. The National Organization for Women, NOW, was started in an effort to correct the problem. The movement for women's equality was known as the Women's Liberation Movement. Activists were called women's libbers. They called each other sisters. Early activists were usually rich, liberal, white women. Later activists included women of all ages, women of color, rich and poor, educated and uneducated. They acted together to win recognition for the work done by all women in America. You can find our series online with transcripts, MP3s, podcasts, and pictures at voaspecialenglish.com. You can also follow us on Facebook and Twitter at VOA Learning English. I'm Steve Ember, inviting you to join us again next week for The Making of a Nation, American History in VOA Special English.